It started with my first apartment. My stuff would disappear. Small stuff. Like cigarette lighters. Yes. I was a smoker back then. Where's my lighter? I asked Dave, my best friend and roommate at the time. Dave, who had a personalized gold Zippo lighter with his name engraved in fancy letters, had no time for such cheap, novelty items. Plus, he was a slob. He wouldn't put his own stuff away, let alone someone else's stuff. It wasn't him. I shrugged it off. The problem was, my stuff kept disappearing. Sure enough, every time I lost something, a lighter, toothbrush, my wallet, you get the picture, it would always end up in the drawer closest to the fridge, the junk drawer. My girlfriend Taylor was my usual suspect. Why'd you keep putting my stuff in the drawer? I'd ask accusingly. I was 100% convinced of her guilt. Her denial was adamant, needless to say. I assumed it was Taylor, who unofficially moved in with me. Maybe this was her thing, her peculiarity. We've all got one, right? Back then, I was only mildly concerned with my disappearing stuff. I mean, at least I knew where to look. It became a running joke. The joke was on me. Let's fast forward a few years, shall we? Dave grew weary of my little problem. As he called it, he was worried his stuff would inevitably go missing. So he went back home to live with his parents, while I rented the bottom floor of a house. That was the end of my first apartment. I presumed my little problem was over. The first Monday in my new home proved otherwise. I ended up being late for work that day because my alarm hadn't gone off. How could it? My alarm clock was nowhere to be seen. Panic struck hard and fast. There's nothing worse than waking up late for work on a Monday morning. I trudged towards the kitchen, squint-eyed and confused. When I opened the drawer closest to the fridge, voila, my alarm clock. For a moment I stood frozen in my tracks, slippers on my feet, hair in disarray. A dreadful feeling sank to the pit of my stomach. This can't be happening. Not again. I began to wonder if I was a sleepwalker. If I was, surely someone would have noticed by now. No, it wasn't that. But then who or what was taking my stuff? There's nobody here but me. Now that I was living alone, I started noticing the signs. There was a presence that would come around at night, like a cool breeze on an otherwise warm day. I tried to ignore it. I had to, otherwise my mind would crumble like a cracker. It wasn't easy. Deep down, I knew someone was watching me. Someone, or something. Although there was no rhyme or reason as to how often my stuff would go missing, the disappearances only occurred while I was asleep. This made me uneasy. It brought about too many questions. Questions with scary answers. No doubt. Cue the insomnia. By the time I reached my mid-30s, I'd learned to hide my little secret as best I could, but it was no use. The people closest to me would always find out, most notably my girlfriends. By now, Taylor was at her wit's end. It was a pillow, of all things, that final did her in. Like most weekends, she'd spend the night, and when we woke up, our pillow was gone. I checked around the bed. Nothing. The darn thing was stuffed into the junk drawer like a jack-in-the-box, all cranked up and ready to erupt. Which it did, as soon as I opened the damn drawer. That's when Taylor dumped me. She said she no longer felt safe around me. Honestly, I couldn't blame her. I didn't feel safe around me either, especially at night. Life went on as it does. And a year or so later I met Ashley. We hit it off right away. The first night Ashley stayed over I was a nervous wreck. And not just for the usual reasons. I was petrified something would disappear in the middle of the night and end up you know where. My fears proved correct. Her bra went missing. It should have been lying on the floor, next to the bed. It wasn't. It was gone. She thought I was playing a childish prank, having a laugh at her expense. If only that was the case. My stomach sank to the bottom of my feet. I really liked Ashley. This could ruin everything. With feet like hammers, I charged into the kitchen and opened the junk drawer. There it was. Ashley's bra. This was the first time something that wasn't mine ended up here. I didn't know what to make of this. At the moment, I had bigger fish to fry. How do I return the bra while convincing her I'm not the world's biggest creep? In the end, Ashley forced the truth out of me. And to my surprise, she believed me. Her grandmother, she told me, had been haunted by spirits most of her life. She wouldn't go into detail, but I could tell she was intrigued. Ashley was resolute to get to the bottom of this. And that's exactly what she did, for better or for worse, under her guidance. We started to monitor these idiosyncrasies. We set up surveillance. Then we waited. At first, nothing happened, or more accurately, nothing disappeared. It wasn't until the following weekend that my newly acquired iPad went missing. When I awoke, it wasn't on my bedside table where it should have been. I rushed to check the video. The video proved no. The drawer hadn't been tampered with. Nothing opened it or closed it. My iPad simply appeared when I opened the drawer. like it had been there all alone. What if we keep the drawer open at night? Ashley asked. A good idea. That's what we did. The following morning, I woke up missing my pants. I'd left them on the back of my computer chair before going to bed. Now, they were gone. The junk drawer, still in my boxers. I raced to the kitchen, but Ashley had beaten me to it. The look she was giving me wasn't promising. She was trembling, clearly perturbed, pale as paper. "Watch this," she said, barely above a whisper. "You're not going to believe it." The feeling that this wasn't going to end well for me was impossible to ignore. Ashley pressed play. I watched transfixed as the drawer lay open in the waning darkness of nighttime. The kitchen was as quiet as a corpse. She sped up the video. We stared at the open drawer for what seemed like an eternity. Then at 6:06 a.m., my pants appeared out of thin air. "No way," I said in a shaky voice. We watched the video over and over and over again. 6:05. No pants. 6:06. Pants. Ashley zoomed in, analyzing it in every possible way. But ultimately, there was no logical explanation that we could think of. One night, out of desperation, Ashley's BFF decided it would be a good idea to bring over a Ouija board. Ashley was bewitched. I, on the other hand, was skeptical. I'd never used a Ouija board. Nor did I care to. Meddling with dark forces was not my idea of a good time. This was my life we were dealing with. Something told me this was a bad idea. It was. At first, nothing happened. I was getting frustrated. Not to mention deeply embarrassed. I'd done my very best keeping my little secret to myself all these years. Now, this thing started escalating once we placed our fingers on the planchette. I felt a cold, dark presence enter the room. I recognized this presence immediately. An icy shiver ran down my spine. Like when someone drops an ice cube down the back of your shirt. Then, I felt my girlfriend's elbow digging into my ribs, silently insisting I speak up. "Do you have a name?" I asked, with a stutter. It was the first thing that popped into my head. With our fingers bunched tightly together, the planchette moved to the letter J. Then it wafted towards the letter A, followed by C subsequently. It formed a name, Jacob. "I don't know anyone named Jacob," I blurted out, rather abruptly. "Ask it another question," Ashley whispered. Without warning, the Ouija board burst into flames. Apparently, question time was over. Ashley's BFF was downright flabbergasted. Her beloved board now lay in a pile of smoke and ashes. As did my flagging love life. The following day, Ashley said she no longer felt safe around me. It was deja vu all over again. After the breakup, I was all alone again. Except that's not entirely true. I had Jacob. And Jacob, it would seem, was upping his game. Things I'd lost as a teenager started showing up in the junk drawer. First, it was an old baseball card. Mark McGuire's sophomore year. In fact, he was my favorite player growing up. I removed the card from the plastic sleeve and studied it carefully. The sharp look stamped across McGuire's face. The slight crease on the left corner, just above the Athletics logo. It looked exactly as I remembered it. Impossible. The following week it happened again. Only this time it was my very first wallet. The one I'd lost 20 years ago. Me and Dave had gone to Burger King after school that day. We ate inside and took our time doing so. As we were leaving, I stopped to throw out some garbage. Stupidly, I placed my brand new wallet on top of the garbage bin. I got distracted, then I turned and walked away, never to see that wallet again. Until now, I opened it. That new leather smell hit me straight away. The damp, intoxicating aroma wafted into my nostrils like a gentle fog rolling over a hill. "This can't be real," I told myself. "This isn't right." "Jacob," I shouted, seemingly to myself, "where did you find this?" No answer. "Where did it come from?" My voice rose to a fervor. Silence. Something inside me snapped. I broke down. "Why me?" I shouted, in between bouts of weeping. My voice ricocheted around the room. Before falling to my feet, I was completely disheveled. This had gone on too long. It needed to stop. I took a deep breath and counted to 10. What I needed was answers. Who in blue blazes was Jacob anyway? And where did he come from? Ultimately, my boss forced me to take a leave of absence, so I had plenty of time to get to the bottom of this. The problem was, I didn't know where to begin. I was searching for ghosts. A visit to my parents was in order. After a lengthy discussion with my mother, her genuine look of concern was enough to convince me that she knew nothing of the subject. Although there was a flicker in her eyes when I first mentioned my little secret, maybe it was my imagination. Then again, maybe not. My mother has an exception poker face. My dad, on the other hand, "Son," my father said, in his gruff voice, "I think it's time we have ourselves a talk." He fetched his bottle of cognac, then led me to the den, where we talked for the better part of the evening. His words chilled me to the bone. "Your great-grandfather was a war hero," he said, in a faraway voice. And talking First World War, he almost died. Shoulda died too. Some say he got shot up pretty bad. Something saved him. Not a lot is known about the man, because my father, your grandfather, refused to talk about him. What I do know is this. When Gramps came back from the Great War, he came back different. Mean and nasty, he was. He got off playing outlandish pranks on people. His ingenuity knew no bounds. I was stunned, you see. I knew nothing of my great-grandfather. In fact, this was the first I'd ever heard of him. I was on the edge of my seat as my father took me further down the rabbit hole. When he revealed my great-grandfather's name, I nearly peed my pants. Jacob Starr died at 59. Poor bastard didn't reach 60. Many years later, my grandmother made a deathbed confession about the man. At the time, I didn't believe her. In all honesty, I didn't want to believe her. But deep down I knew it was true. My father stopped talking. He ran a meaty hand through his sprinkle of silver hair, lost in memory lane. Meanwhile, my heart was threatening to pound right through my chest and spill out on the floor. Jacob Starr. I gulped. Yes, of course, my father said, clearly startled. I must have mentioned him to you before. He hadn't. But judging from the weary look he was giving me, I wasn't about to bring this up. My father took another drink, then continued. After the war, Jacob Starr opened a magic shop, dealing mostly with black magic and the occult. That's where he met your grandmother. According to her, Jacob had acquired the ability to somehow move through time and space. He learned this trick during the Battle of Passchendaele. He stepped on a landmine. Although it may have been a grenade, or the wrong end of a gun, I can't remember which, and while his body moved through the muddy air, he slipped into another dimension. He opened a portal, a door to the other side. My grandmother believed he's still there. She told me stories of her stuff disappearing after he'd passed, only to reappear in her attic. I was shaking. This was not what I was expecting to hear. But what does this have to do with my disappearing stuff? Why does my stuff always end up in the same drawer? And why is my old stuff starting to show up? Again, my father went quiet. He simply stared into his glass, ignoring the world around him. Just as I thought he would ignore my question, he spoke up. Well now, those are some loaded questions, wouldn't you say? Indeed, they were. I'm sorry, son. I don't have any suitable answers. I've been asking myself those same questions for years. That caught my attention. Suddenly, my father's apprehensiveness made sense. This happened to you as well, I said. This wasn't a question. It was written all over his furrowed face. My father nodded. I first noticed my stuff disappearing when I turned 20. He told me. I thought I was going bonkers. Maybe I was. Your mother seemed to think so. Except, it kept happening. So much so that I became damn near livid, let me tell you. It got to the point where your mother made me see a shrink. My father lowered his head, shamefully, then refilled his glass. I hid this from you as best I could, he added. I mean, it wasn't life-threatening. Just spooky as all hell. One time, I lost my entire Beatles collection on 8-track. I was very agitated by that. Your mother, of course, was glad to see them disappear. But I got the last laugh. I knew where to find them. The junk drawer, I said. Precisely. We spoke for hours. This was the longest time we'd spent together in years. We inevitably changed topics, but not before concluding that once I'd moved away, his stuff stopped disappearing. The torch had been passed to me. I left feeling reinvigorated yet deeply disturbed. If my dead great-grandfather was rummaging through my belongings, how was I to stop him or make a truce? I considered finding an exorcist, if that's even a thing, but decided against it. I'd had enough with the dark forces, thank you very much. Besides, it's not like I was waking up with REDRUM painted over my walls in blood or anything. Jacob was a prankster. Did he really learn the secret of eternal life? And if so, why was he hiding my stuff? Certainly, he could come up with more interesting ways to spend his immortality. This made no sense. As things continued to escalate, I became increasingly aware of Jacob's presence. In fact, he became my unofficial roommate. I'd reach for the bar of soap in the shower, gone. Same goes for my shaving cream, my brush, my favorite coffee mug, small stuff. But still, it was super annoying. Things finally hit a tipping point. This time it was my car keys. Only when I checked the junk drawer, they weren't in there. I threw a fit. I launched everything inside the drawer onto the floor, then proceeded to stomp the stupid drawer into a million pieces. I should have done this sooner. Then I tried pleading with Jacob, begging him to be reasonable. It was my first day back to work after my leave of absence. I needed to arrive on time. There must be a new hiding spot, I concluded. I searched everywhere, tearing my house apart in the process. I didn't have time for this. My keys were nowhere to be found. I called an Uber, kicking myself for not owning a spare set of keys. I arrived to work 10 minutes late. The following morning it was my cell phone. It vanished. My fists were knotted balls of rage. I was furious. I was also terrified. What's next? As if on cue, Friday morning my car went missing. I would have called the police, but my phone was still missing in action. Things were spiraling out of control. I didn't have enough time and money to be constantly replacing my stuff. Phones are expensive, so are cars. Reluctantly, I reached out to Dave, who called the police. Meanwhile, I was forced to miss another day of work. My job was barely hanging on by a thread. When the police arrived, they asked a million questions, none of which I had any answers to. The following day, they dragged me into the station for further questioning. The officer had found surveillance footage of my driveway. This didn't do much for my trust in law enforcement. That said, I watched in complete and utter shock as the officer, a stout woman with long blonde hair cropped tightly into a ponytail, showed me the footage. "Watch this," she said, her face revealing no signs of emotion. I watched. It was an otherwise inert morning. The birds were warming up their throats in song, while the sun settled itself upon the budding boulevard. Nobody was near my house, yet at precisely 6:06 a.m. my car vanished into thin air. Poof, gone, just like that. I felt sick to my stomach. My mind was on the blink. I could tell the officer was equally perplexed. Neither of us had a valid explanation. This was something out of the X-Files. My father showed up later that night. To my amazement, he drove over in my car. He says the car arrived unannounced. Keys in the ignition. He tried calling me, but I wouldn't answer my phone. I shook my hook and tried not to scream bloody murder. I examined my car thoroughly. My phone was inside the glove compartment. That's not all. My old hockey bag was inside the truck, fuming like leftover garbage from a ratty dumpster. The smell was atrocious. You'd think there was a dead body inside it. I certainly wasn't going to check. My father handed me the only remaining picture of Jacob Starr. My great-grandfather was sharply dressed in his WW1 military uniform, with a smug sneer stretched across his stern face. His resemblance to me was striking. I placed the black and white photograph in the living room, hoping it would be considered a peace offering. So far, so good. A month has gone by and I haven't lost any more stuff. At home, that is. I keep losing random stuff at work. Pens, pencils, staplers and such. They always end up in drawer at the bottom of my desk. Last week it was a co-worker's laptop. I had a hell of a time trying to explain that one. Yesterday, it was my data report on my big project, after I'd handed it in. So, there's that. My coworkers are starting to ask questions, reluctantly. I told them about Jacob. What choice did I have? The woman whose laptop vanished, only to be discovered in the bowels of my office desk, was intrigued. After a week of sleuthing, she discovered something unexpected, something else to keep me up at night. Turns out, the century-old building I work at once housed a magic shop named Starlight. Starbright. Rumors of Aleister Crowley frequenting the shop run rampant. My co-worker even managed to dig up the proprietor's name, Jacob Starr. So, there's that.